This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Hey, welcome to 12 Tone. About a month ago, I got an email from a musician named Ruben Nebbit Blades who'd been experimenting with what they called anti-scales and was wondering if I had ever seen them before. I hadn't, but it seemed like an interesting idea, so with Ruben's permission, I started playing around with it to see what I could find, and I think I'm ready to share my results. First though, let's talk about what these anti-scales are. They're pretty closely related to what's called a complement, which is a scale made out of all the notes that aren't in a different scale. So if we take F major, we have F, but we don't have F sharp, so we'll put that over here to keep track. Then we have G, but no G sharp, so that goes on our list too. Speeding this up a bit, we have A, we have B flat, we don't have B, we have C, we don't have C sharp, we have D, we don't have D sharp, and we have E. And if we take these extra notes and arrange them like so, we see that the complement of F major is a scale called B major pentatonic. Sort of. Why only sort of? Well, this process is what's called modally invariant, which is a fancy way of saying it doesn't matter which note is the root. We said this was B major pentatonic, but we could have just as easily arranged the notes like this and got G sharp minor pentatonic instead. Playing the same notes but using a different root gives you what's called a mode, and since any of these five notes could be the root, all five modes of the scale are totally valid complements of F major. And it gets even worse because major has modes too. We called this F major, but if we called it D minor instead, it would have had the same notes and thus the same complement, so really assigning any scale names at all is kind of misleading. All we can really say is that these five notes in some order are the complement of these seven notes in some order. Ruben's anti-scales, on the other hand, work a little differently. Instead of just being all the notes missing from the parent scale, an anti-scale is all those notes but played over the same root, so F major would flip into this. These five notes form the complement, but we've held onto the F as well, giving us a six-note scale that's the unique polar opposite of the seven-note scale we started with. The process is no longer modally invariant. Every anti-scale is different. So what can we do with this? Well, from a composition perspective, the first thing that comes to mind is a technique I used to play around with back in college, which I called collaborative chromatics. In it, two different parts, either two sections of a song or two simultaneous instrumental lines if I was feeling frisky, would be written in two different scales such that while each one was reasonably normal on its own, the two parts taken together used all 12 notes. The goal, in effect, was to juxtapose two very different tonal landscapes into one coherent whole. To be honest, I never got very far with it, but in retrospect, maybe that's because I was stuck using complements, which made it really hard to make them feel connected. Maybe if I'd been using anti-scales instead, the shared root would have given me the grounding I needed in order to create something that actually, you know, worked. But these days I'm more of a theorist than a composer, so what really got me excited here was looking at what this process could tell us about the structure of these scales. There's a lot of angles to approach this from, but one thing immediately stood out to me. Here, let's look at anti-major again. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, this looks really familiar. If I just sneak an extra note in the middle here, we get this, which is a scale called Locrian. And here's the thing, Locrian is a mode of major. Specifically, it's the seventh mode, so F Locrian is all the same notes as G flat major, but played with F as the root. So anti-major is a subset of Locrian, and Locrian is a mode of major, which means that effectively anti-major is major, just jumbled around and with a hole poked in the middle. I decided to call this property anti-scale equivalence, and unlike with complements, it's not modally invariant. Like natural minor is another mode of major, but if we take its anti-scale, we get something with a minor second and a major third, which is an interval pattern that none of minor's modes have. Going through, only four of major's modes have this equivalence: major, Locrian, Lydian, the fourth mode, and Phrygian, the second. The other three all flip into weird scales from outside the modal family. So naturally, I started wondering how common this property was. Do most seven-note scales have it? Is it just these four? I sat down to work it all out and immediately got bored. In my defense, there's 462 possible seven-note scales, and I'd have to check each one's anti-scale against all its modes, which sounds exhausting. Fortunately, doing repetitive calculations on large datasets is exactly what computers are made for, and my dad happens to be a pretty accomplished programmer, so he and I worked together to write a quick program to find all the seven-note scales with anti-scale equivalents. Turns out there's 68, which is a much more reasonable number to work with. Once I had that list, I went through it to see what I could find that might help me explain how this property property works, but before I get to those results, I gotta do a quick definition. This problem is pretty close to a field called musical set theory, which mainly concerns itself with objects called sets. A set is kind of like a modal family. If you took all the possible major scales and all their modes and bundled those all together, you'd have a set. Specifically, you'd have set FN735, but the name's not super important here. What matters is that you're reducing the scale to its pattern of intervals without worrying about what the actual pitches are or which one is the root. So anyway, what did I find? Well, most of my initial guesses proved wrong. Like, from the first couple examples I played with, I expected the parent scales to have a lot of minor seconds and major sevenths. I figured having the notes right next to the root on either side might make it easier to avoid awkward spacing elsewhere, because it let you get a half step into your parent scale without forcing your anti-scale to skip two notes in a row, but it turns out that, if anything, there's fewer of those notes than you'd expect. Not by a huge margin and probably not significant, but still. Not what I was expecting. I also thought I'd see some sort of restriction on the size of scale steps. Any large leaps in the parent scale would correspond to long runs of half steps in the anti-scale, which would then have to be matched back into the parent scale, and I figured some combinations might just be impossible, but turns out, nope. Pretty much every combination of scale steps I could think of made it onto the list somewhere. But it wasn't all failures. I had also guessed that many of the sets represented on my list would be non-invertible. Effectively, they'd have a mode that was a palindrome, like Dorian, the second mode of major. Here we start with a whole step, and we also end with a whole step. Going inward, we have these half steps, then these whole steps, then finally another whole step in the middle. Basically, the interval pattern is the same in either direction, so if we turn the whole thing upside down, we get the same scale we started with. And since, as we mentioned, sets are just interval patterns, if one mode inverts to itself, then all the other modes will wind up inverting to each other, and the family as a whole won't actually invert at all. Now, not all the scales on my list do this. There's 16 sets represented, and only 9 of them are non-invertible, which is barely over half. But on the other hand, there's only 10 non-invertible 7-note sets total, which means 90% of them are represented here, so while anti-scale equivalence doesn't predict non-inversion, non-inversion does a pretty good job predicting anti-scale equivalence, which probably means something. Another potentially important observation is that most of the sets on my list include their prime form. The prime form is basically the mode where all the notes are as flat as possible, so like major's prime form is Locrian, because every other mode has at least one note that's higher than the corresponding pitch in Locrian. There's some extra rules for resolving ties, but basically, I figured you were more likely to find this property on the extreme ends of modal families, and the prime form is one of those extremes, so it seemed likely that if the set could be equivalent at all, the prime form would be one of the scales that was. And as it turns out, I was right. Of the 16 sets, 13 of them include their prime form. But the big break came when I decided to check the missing notes. Basically, when you turn a 7-note parent scale into a 6-note anti-scale, you have to add one note back in order to get your complete mode, so like if you take anti-major, you have to add a perfect fourth in order to make Locrian. Some scales actually have a couple options here, like anti-Locrian, where you can add a perfect fourth to get back to major, but you can also add a tritone to get another mode, Lydian. Anyway, I was curious if there was any pattern to the notes you had to add, so I went through and yeah. There was a pattern, alright. Of the 68 scales on my list, 36 of them had the tritone as an option, 30 of which had it as their only option. It was by far the most common missing note, so why? Well, I'd guess it has something to do with the fact that the tritone is symmetrical. F to B is a tritone, and B to F is too. This means that every scale with a tritone also has a mode with a tritone, and since the missing note is just the one that both scales share, it's easy to see why this one would be so popular. But I think it's more than that. Being symmetrical means the tritone splits the octave cleanly in two, so all we have to do is line up the notes in the bottom half with the gaps in the top half so that when we flip the scale, those notes and gaps just switch places, giving us a really easy template for anti-scale equivalence. And this explanation is supported by looking at the rest of the missing note data. Second place is a tie between the minor third and the major sixth. Much like the tritone splits the octave in half, these two intervals split the tritone in half, giving us a more involved version of the same technique. Seeing a lot of those two then implies that octave divisions are important here. But probably the best evidence comes from looking at the only two notes that aren't on the list at all, the major third and the minor sixth. These two intervals together divide the octave up into three equal sections, the only odd number you can divide it by in standard tuning. Having three equal sections means we'd have to line up the notes in the bottom third with the gaps in the middle, which would then be lined up with the notes in the top, which if we continue past the octave would then be lined up with the gaps in the bottom, but since they already have to be lined up with the notes in the bottom, this creates an impossible template, which means these notes can never be shared between a parent scale and its target mode. I think. That's my theory anyway, and the data seems to support it. So what does this all mean? Yeah, good question. I'm not entirely sure what to do with it. I have some observations and some possible explanations, but nothing groundbreaking yet. It's kind of a weird problem. It feels like it belongs to musical set theory, but most of the serious work in that field is done with stuff that's modally invariant. Heck, getting rid of the concept of a root is like half the point of set theory, so the question of anti-scale equivalence doesn't quite fit in. It's a conceptual outlier. But hey, I'm far from the best set theorist out there, so if anyone wants to take a crack at this, I've included my list in the description, along with most of the stuff I checked for, so feel free to take a look and see what you come up with. And while you're exploring new things, why not check out this video's sponsor, Skillshare? It's a really cool online learning platform with over 25,000 lessons in music production, design, cooking, and so much more. In fact, my friend and fellow YouTuber Mike Boyd recently released a course over there called Guitar Fundamentals to help you get started learning one of the most popular instruments in modern music. Plus, he also has another course about how to pick up new skills quickly, which, if you're at all familiar with Mike's work, you know he's an expert at. Skillshare is offering a free 2-month trial membership to the first 500 12-tone viewers to click the link in the description, which includes full premium access so you can try out all sorts of classes on whatever you want to learn, and if you like what you see, sticking around is super affordable, with premium plans starting under 10 bucks a month. It's a great deal, but you don't have to take my word for it. Again, there's 2 free months with a link in the description, so you can try it out yourself risk-free. And hey, thanks for watching, and thanks to our Patreon patrons for supporting us and making these videos possible. If you want to help out and get some sweet perks like sneak peeks of upcoming episodes, there's a link to our Patreon on screen now. You can also join our mailing list to find out about new episodes, like, share, comment, subscribe, and above all, keep on rocking.